So, what's an integrated development environment? Classically, in most systems, it's the editor, which is also known, well, it's a glorified editor, which is the hub. It invokes the compiler, it processes error messages, it runs the program, it has a debugging interface, it does cross-referencing and maybe other features. The first ones were language-specific, so we had Smalltalk 80 with its code browser, there was Turbo Pascal, and Holon 4 is our fourth entry into this field. And one characteristic of all this is that there's no choice of editor, and programmers are pretty married to the editor, at least it's true for me and many that I know. So if you tell me to use Holon 4 and it doesn't work with Emacs, I'm unlikely to use it. Anyway, the first systems, they were specific so they had one combination of language, system, and editor, which was all into one. So that was a really integrated development environment. Later, we had these cross-language IDEs, which were just enhanced editors like Eclipse, IntelliJ IDEA, and a recent entry is Visual Studio Code. There's also one which I like to use, which is Emacs, and this has actually a long history as integrated development environment, because it was already Richard Gabriel's company, which was called Lucid. Before they folded, they made an IDE system called Energize, and it used Emacs as its editor. But let's get back to the topic. Chief of supports Emacs as IDE and a little bit VI too. And I'll give you a demo of how this works later. So next, there's a new development in IDEs, which is a language server protocol. Basically, it's a defined interface between the language systems and the IDEs. And the advantage of this is, or let's say the disadvantage of the traditional way is that if I want to do to integrate with an IDE, I did have to write an interface, one for Eclipse and one for IntelliJ and one for Visual Studio Code and one for Emacs and so on. If you have N languages and M IDEs, you need N times M interfaces, which is not very good. With the language server protocol, the theory is that I write one interface from my language system to the language server protocol, and the editors write one interface from the language server protocol to the editor, and then every editor can work with every language system. The nice thing is that this gives us editor choice, so you can then choose any editor that supports the language server protocol. So in the future, it may be interesting to add language server protocol to fourth systems. This is despite what I'm going to tell you next. I mean, the classical fourth IDE approach is quite different, but I think depending on the situation, sometimes I like it this editor-centric IDE style more, and sometimes I like the classical fourth style more. So, what is the classical fourth style? The traditional fourth approach. It uses the fourth command line as the hub instead of the editor. So it allows you to show the source code of a word or edit it with your favorite editor. So the favorite editor is really the very nice feature about this. It allows you to load the program, run the program, debug the program, do cross-referencing, inspect the documentation, show the generated code, or show other system state. And the next thing I'll do is I'll give you a demo of all these features. So this, and I'm going to share my entire screen. Come on. Does it work?
We still see the demo.
Yes, and I'm trying to share my entire screen and it doesn't work. That's not great. Application window is possible, but I need two windows. That's the problem.
When you need two windows, you have to share your screen, Anton.
Yes. Yeah. But it doesn't give me the option to sharing the screen.
Yesterday was very right.
You need to share your camera.
No, as far as I know, you first have to quit your presenting screen and then reopen it.
So Anton, try to abort the current presentation.
Okay. So let's share my screen again. No, it doesn't want to share it. It just wants to share the application window. So I can share this one.
In the list of all,
Yes, but the problem is, of course,
just a single window.
It's just a single window, and I need two.
Yesterday I recognized that in the list of application windows down below, really at the end of that list, there was screen one and screen two in my setup. So can you scroll in that list?
No, that's just the three applications that I have.
Okay.
Okay. Anyway, I'll do what I can. It's a feature of this Chromium thing that I can. Camera, microphone, sound, set settings. No, this is not it. Oh, sorry about this problem. Oh, the privacy and security. Permissions.
That's where I found it yesterday, Anton. I was using Firefox, but I had to find a place where Firefox wouldn't think I was violating my own privacy by sharing my screen. And once I checked that off, I was allowed to share the screen.
Yeah. Location, camera, microphone, motion sensors, notifications, no, images. I don't find it. Sorry about that.
Which browser are you using?
Chromium. I can try changing to Firefox, but that's going to take a minute. But it's probably better than what I'm doing now.
Firefox definitely worked yesterday for me, and I'm not an expert. First time I used it.
So I'm leaving and trying the same in Firefox. Sorry about it.
You need to have an extension on Chromium for screen sharing.
Okay. So I'm switching to Firefox. I'll see you in a moment.
So I can start my upload again.
Let's see, where is Klaus?
Klaus, quick. Yes.
Ah, yeah, right. Thank you, Bernd.
Klaus, quick with your upload, because if Anton comes back, we will get
I'm hurrying.
Normally, I always have a wonderful technical difficulty screen for Twitch.
Yeah,
unfortunately, I don't have it now.
It should be there now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I can give it back to...
And here we go. Great. We can see that, Anton.
So, yeah, you can see that. Great. So, right. So, the first thing I'm going to present is the classically editor-centric IDE thing. And, oh. So what you need to do to prepare for this is you need to call gforth with etags.fs, which is basically to create the tags file and the file I want to index. So it creates an index for the file I want to process. And what's going on here?
Minus pi, what is?
Oh, minus e pi, yes.
Minus e.
Yeah. So, we now have a text file, and I can, for example, so you've seen I'm in Emacs, and I say meta dot, and kind of find a tag, and the tag I want to find is the one for the word compute, and it will tell me that the tags has changed, read the new contents, yes, and I'm right at compute. And when I'm, for example, what is this first set I'm looking at? I can say meta dot here, and it will suggest that I use first set as the word I'm looking for. And when I press enter, I'm at the definition of first set, which is here. And I can also do meta comma to get back. So basically, this is just go to the definition and go back. What else do we have? I also have prepared a version of the same files with some tracers. So tracers are debugging. They help in debugging. I will explain that in a moment. And with an actual error. So I can run it from Emacs by saying, so you can get the information about this by looking for compilation mode in the Emacs documentation. So I'm running the compile command gforth broken / prims2x.fs, which is basically the same files with just some editing, and I'm leaving it so it doesn't hang in the in the compilation buffer for all times the process. So, and we get output of the buffer. So let's see what we have here. So these are the these lines are the outputs of the tracers. So basically, every time a tracer is executed, it shows me the source code position of the tracer and the stack contents. You also see here some things that don't look like normal things that you see on .s output. This is what we get from in the intelligent.s. It's called dot dot dot, and it tries to give you some more information on what it is. And in particular, if it sees something that looks like an address in the dictionary, it will not give you some huge number, but instead it will look for a name close to it and will give you the body address of the name plus an offset. All right. And so after outputting some tracers, we get to the error and then get a backtrace. So it says here, when running this word parser here in this position, we did get an invalid memory address error. And we have a backtrace here, and for each line, so basically, which is the contents of the return stack. And for each line in the backtrace, we get the source code position, and we get the word that corresponds to that. So one cool feature of this Emacs mode of this compilation buffer mode is we can actually directly go to the source code place that's indicated by this position. So I click on it and it tells me this is here and this is here. And there's also an actual mode which I can start with Control C, Control F. No, was it not? Oh, it was. Oh, I'm in the wrong buffer. Okay. Control C, Control F. That's right. So when I'm, then it's very simple. Just when I go across a source code position, it displays the corresponding code in the other window. So what do we have here? Yeah, one problem is it doesn't like these things, so I have to skip over that. But here we see the call to parser, which invoked the error, and I have to go back here again. When I then go to a source code position, it shows, yeah. So here in the zero fetch, it actually happened to produce the error. So it's not surprising that when we fetch from address zero, we get an invalid memory address. There's some shortcoming here, which we have to address at some point. It doesn't recognize these as source code positions, but for this one, it works again. So next we have we switch to the fourth variant of that. So we can say gforth, and then we can say include Claude prims to X. And now we can, for example, look for a specific word. Earlier we wanted to look for compute. We can do this here, locate compute. And it displays this word. And we are now in a kind of less like mode. So if we want to see more context, we can use the cursor buttons to see more. So if I press cursor up, it shows more above. And if I press cursor down, it shows more below. Or alternatively, we can also edit. We can invoke the editor. So now that I've done a locate of compute, I can just say G, and it invokes the editor. And because I haven't set the editor, the default editor is VI. So it enters VI and it places the cursor at the line that contains compute. And if I do Q, I'm back in fourth. And alternatively, I could also directly say edit compute, and also, no, this doesn't work. And also go to this, get the same result. So I don't need to say locate first. Mm-hmm. Right. Next, I talked about free choice of editor. Of course, I use my favorite editor, which is Emacs. And the nice thing about Emacs is it has I can invoke it with Emacs client. So I have an Emacs running, and the Emacs client always uses the existing Emacs instead of starting a new one. So I say export editor equals Emacs client, and I start G4th again. And when I need to first load. Include this, and now I can say edit compute, and you saw something in the we are now here, the cursor is at the definition of compute now, and you see below, so here you see you have gray.fs in the directory G4th, and here you have gray.fs in broken. So you see a slight difference because the broken one has here the tracer and here the zero fetch, and the unbroken one doesn't have these things. So what's next in my program? Yes, I can also now say things like where. Compute, and I get all the places. So this is the cross-referencing part. I get all the places where the word compute occurs, and now I can say I want to see where the fourth. So I have at the right-hand side I have an index, and I can say I want the. To use the one to see the one that's at index 2, I'll say WW. And I can also then say I want the next where, and it shows me the next one, and the next where, and it shows me the next one, and so on. Alternatively, I can also say free GGW, and this means basically the GG sets up preloads basically then the next word that's in this whole set of locating words actually invokes the editor instead of displaying the code. So if I say 3GGWW, it will not show the code in the fourth window, but it will do it in the editor window. And this is what happens here. Right. So next, I want to show again what happens when we have a broken when we invoke the broken version. So here you see in green the outputs of the tracers, and in red the backtrace, which I already explained. The cool thing is I can now show, for example, the code that contains this that's at this position here. 0 pt, and it shows, yeah, quite a little bit off. So there's an off by one error, which we have to fix yet. It does work for the next backtrace item. And so this is exactly at the right place. There's a compute here, and it said here, the compute call is it is. And if you consider that this here is inside compute, it's obviously the right one. And if we show another one, we are again wrong. So I think the primitives are, it's doing it wrong for the primitives. That's the one off by one error for primitives, but not for colon definitions. Right. So yeah, one other thing I wanted to show while I'm at it. You can also, you don't just get this as output, you can also do it as input. And you now have a value on the stack, and this is actually the address that would otherwise have been displayed. And Andrew Haley will be delighted to see that when I do locate of this, I get the recognizer that actually recognizes this kind of thing. So it's the rec body. So what next? Yeah, that was that. So the final sequence, I'm again starting with G4, including the non-broken one. And the nice thing in 4th is I can also locate system code. So I can locate if. I can also invoke help for words and basically get the same locate interface for this. So I can scroll, I can extend this further up or further down. And I can also look up the source code for primitives. So if I say locate apps, I get the source code of the primitive apps. So you see here there's the fourth primitive input syntax, which contains some part in C code and some replacement code in fourth. And here the name and stack effect and word set stuff. And I've talked about this in earlier talks. What else do we have? We can also see use where on system words to see how often they occur. So you see we have 48 instances of where, and of course it's a little bit uncomfortable to use the command line words for where for this many. So I can also say where g move, and it will actually put me put the where in the editor, and I can then say Control C, Control F, and step through all the occurrences of move in the source code. So another one. So we can not just look at the source code, we can also look at the generated code to see the difference. I'll first show the source code for a word, sc maxdepth. So here you have a simple word, the source code for a simple word, it's sc maxdepth, and we can also see, so we can, that's the source code, and the generated code, we can look at it with sc maxdepth. And we see, so the output of C tries to be close to the source code. We see that the max dex has been expanded into 4, but the rest is pretty much like it used to be. We are missing the stack command because it's not in the generated code, but other than that, it looks pretty normal. We can also see something that's so sometimes we want to have something that's more closer to the so that shows the threaded code. We can so do simple C as C max depth, and we here see threaded code. So we have before the 4 we have a lit and the max depths plus is compiled into a lit plus and so on. We also have another version which is called C code, where we see the threaded code interspersed with the native code. I need to say what I want to display. Max. So you see here, basically, here we have a lit, and here you have the code for the lit, and here you have the times, and you have the code for the times. And so this is relatively long for the G4, for the debugging engine. It's a bit shorter for G4 fast. Right. So what else? Yeah, one other aspect. So why do you want the C really useful these days? Now that we have locate, it's useful when you have a code generator. So when you do locate primitives to something, you see some kind of source code which you don't quite understand, because this is source code for a grammar, and parser is a parser generator, and it generates actual parser code for primitives to something. And if you want to see what's being generated for primitives to something, you see it generates a colon definition with some interesting control structures. So basically you have for this stars, let's do this one, for this star you have a begin while repeat thing generated. All right, so what else? Yeah, that's about it. So questions. Oh no, I'm not quite done. I'm going back to Firefox. Stop screen sharing and get back to my presentation. And it's the EDE presentation. Firm. So that was the demo, and the rest is quick. Yeah, so what is the implementation cost? Basically, in terms of factor, it's a big implementation cost. In terms of overall memory of a modern machine, it's minuscule. So basically, the code, the sizes we had before were of, that's for a G4 system with all everything included, but no application code. It's 548 kilobytes of dictionary and 751 kilobytes of native code. So that's a 64-bit system. For locate, this costs 32 kilobytes, and this is already included in this 548. The var costs 619 kilobytes. So basically, for every occurrence of a word in source code, we store the word and we store its location, and this costs. For the backtrace, we basically need just the same size as the dictionary, because for every position, for every cell in the dictionary, we store the source code location from where the code was generated. All right, so overall, in conclusion, many languages use the editor as a hub. Forth traditionally uses the command line as the hub. This works, the one benefit is that this works with your favorite editor. We have locate, we have var for cross-referencing, we have backtraces, we have help for documentation, we have C for showing the generated code. And the nice thing is that it also covers system code. And that was it. Thank you. Questions?
Yes, Anton. Backtrace. So I'm assuming that you're copying all of the call locations somewhere when the program is executing. How much does that hurt the efficiency?
This doesn't cost execution speed. So it just costs memory.
I guess I don't understand that. We have to store some information.
Yes. I mean, there's, of course, for the backtrace, there is some cost, but that cost has already been there before. You have the difference between the debugging engine, which is slower by, I don't know, 1.5 times or so, and G4 fast, which is faster and which doesn't do such nice backtraces. Geralt, did you want to say something? No.
Sorry, I have to unmute myself. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, then go ahead, Geralt.
Yes, I was already asking, but forgot to unmute. Sorry about that. So my question was, you mentioned that this common language protocol to integrate into IDEs.
Language server protocol,
language,
yes.
Language server protocol, okay. How much effort do you think it will be from this time? Because it seems you have all the primitives and you only need to implement the protocol. Or is there anything else? And how much effort will it be to implement that?
I haven't looked at the details, but I mean, it's something that was invented at Microsoft. So,
It is JSON and IPC.
So Ulrich?
Yeah, thinking of traditional force systems, they were operating system and development environment and runtime environment all in one. So you had blocks, of course, but if you think of with Polyforce, for example, or others, if you think of FPC, for example, it had an integrated stream editor as well. So what do you think of coming to that level again and having a GeForce written text editor that provides us with all the functionality that we desire?
We have been discussing this because it's missing on Android, but yeah, better talk to Bernd at some point. Martin?
Yes, I have one question. When I'm looking at the Emacs and GeForce chapter in the manual, how actual is it?
It's pretty. I mean, I haven't changed it. So, I think since 7.0, so it's pretty current. But of course, all the new stuff is with the stuff that's from the fourth command line.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So I think we have to stop with the questions right now, because there's a second part of Anton.